Hi, my name is Tyler Browski. We're going to get started. It's my absolute pleasure to introduce the moderator for tonight's panel and the star of Intimate Apparel and a new company member at Trinity Rep, which we're so excited about, Mia Ellis.
Thank you so much for joining us this evening for a wonderful conversation. I hope it will be. I'm certain it will be about intimate apparel. We've titled this conversation "Peeling Back the Layers: An Intimate Knowledge of Women's Undergarments," but we certainly hope to really get under the top layers of what this play is about and just open up the floor to talk about so many different things that I feel like this play puts into the foreground as far as women and political issues and money and race and religion and so forth and so on. So I'm going to start by allowing each of our panelists to introduce themselves and sort of their field of study slash area of expertise. So if we could start with Matthew.
Sure, yeah. My name is Matthew Guterl. I'm a historian. I'm also the chair of the American Studies Department at Brown and professor of Africana studies as well, and I've written on the history of race and race relations over the long 20th century.
My name is Radiclani, Clytus. I am a professor in the English department and American studies jointly at Brown University, and I primarily work on 19th century visual culture, so it's kind of odd to be on a panel about intimate apparel, where it would be, you know, the 19th century is scandalous just to show an ankle, so of course, it's a kind of interested in that regard. But I primarily write on 19th century African-American visual sensibilities as related to periodical culture and how the American Anti-Slavery Society used visual images as part of its kind of conversionary rhetoric and its campaign to end slavery in the US. And a lot of that has a great deal to do with sartorial consciousness, but not so much in the same regard as in the 20th century.
I'm a curator in the Costume and Textiles Department of the RISD Museum. So I actually am very much involved with, you know, handling the very like material stuff that we're talking about. Our collection has, you know, pieces from, you know, all over the world and from 3500 BC to the present. So this is one small part of what, you know, the lingerie is one small part of what I'm seeing every day. And you know, some of my more recent projects have involved actually men's clothing. I just worked with a co-curator to put up the show "Art is Rebel Dandy, Men of Fashion" at the museum. So this is, you know, this is just another aspect of what I do and what I look at. But you know, is that we teach with this type of material all the time.
Carol Schwebel, and I'm owner of Ruth's Lingerie. I am third generation of women at Ruth's Lingerie. So as a family, we probably date almost back to the 1905, having worked within the lingerie industry. This is second career for me. My background is in education.
Wonderful. Thank you all so much for being here. Well, I'd love to start the conversation with a rather fun question, about lingerie and what you can tell us about lingerie for women today, and undergarments and sort of what that is as far as what's popular right now in lingerie. Because we're going to go backwards in the opposite of what's popular now is you.
To me, part of the media has been the message. I think more so maybe than any other time is that we're told what we're supposed to look like and what we're supposed to wear. And I get fascinated with that to a certain extent, you know, and what's become popular. So you have all these molded cut bras, and you have, it's like in underpants, you're not supposed to see the lines. It's like, what are they trying to convey? You're not supposed to see anything, but yet you're supposed to know it's all there. So that kind of issue, you know, fascinates me, and the changes that happens with that. You know, I could talk not used to doing this kind of talk, so it's a little more difficult. The changes are there, I think, clearly. I love when I have, say, the teenager that comes out that thinks it all should hang up because they're looking at the pictures in the magazines. And yet you have the child who's developing at age 12 or 13 who wishes that it never happened. We see it all. We see all of the changes, all the different shapes and the desires and people who want to be something. You know, it's such a woman's identity.
I also think it's really interesting that, you know, lingerie makes people feel a certain way, and that there is a certain amount of freedom that comes with the lingerie of today that is very different from what lingerie was like in 1905. So if we could talk a little bit about where we've come from as far as lingerie is concerned, which is a great, you know, beginning from intimate apparel, where you have this sort of world where corsets are queen, I guess. You know, they are the thing to have, the thing to be wearing, and sort of how we came from corsets to today.
Well, I tried to read up a little bit before coming, and one thing that struck me is that when the corsets were made back, say, in the era where you do, everything was done individually. So the corset was made for the individual body and for the individual body's measurements. But so were the outer clothing probably made. So it was to enhance the figure. I think today what we're getting is everybody's trying to squeeze into something that's already pre-manufactured, pre-made, pre-sized. So in some respects, I think they made the more flexibility then because it was made for you and to enhance what you wanted to present. Like that's one, you know, kind of major change. It talks about, you know, the first bras not really beginning until around the 1920s or so, and that like cup size is not coming until later. That didn't occur to me. So everything was more individualized early on. Afterwards, you were trying to be something that somebody told you you were supposed to be. And I think of, you know, the curating the fabrics, I think one of the more major differences we say see maybe from the 1950s to now is the choice of fabrications with all of the latex and the spandex and the everything molds more. But before we were dealing with the cottons that weren't going to give or the silk.
Yeah, feel free to talk a little bit about corsets and sort of what you've been privy to and have had the opportunity to handle as a curator.
So handle, but not wear. you're the one who probably have experience from wearing. Maybe other people do, but. but in terms of, you know, looking at the materials, I mean, especially we have the earliest ones, corsets that we have are dated to the 18th century, and they're called stays at that point. And there, you know, that comes from the word to stay the body. So literally, you know, they're just kind of inverted triangles, and that's what your body is supposed to look. And kind of everything is suppressed in terms of curves. So as you enter into the 19th century, you start to see the curves really come in, but what remains the same is the emphasis on the waist, on a very small waist. And so you have, you know, the undergarments to of course kind of promote that silhouette, but you also, you know, this is where you, throughout the 19th century is when you see the big skirts that also kind of work as a visual device to make your waist look smaller. And then, you know, it's what's interesting is that there really is kind of a rise and fall. You know, at the beginning of the 19th century, those stays really almost disappear. They don't really disappear, but there's a lot of discussion about women who are throwing off the stays because it's a very different silhouette. It's this like very straight columnar silhouette. There's still women, even when there's an outcry about, you know, women throwing off the undergarments, you know, say at that time in the early 19th century and in the 1920s, they're very strong undergarments at those times to kind of rein in the body and keep in, you know, make it mold to the preferred silhouette, which is, you know, which is interesting. I think it really, but it is around the time of the play, around 1905, that you start seeing the corset makers get worried about women kind of throwing, you know, moving away from wearing the corset, and the lines are starting to change a lot.
If you could talk a little bit more about how have observing corsets and where their place lies as far as a woman and her status in the world, mm-hmm. and what underwear was like for a woman who, let's say, is in the serving class or who is in the middle class or the upper class, and what the difference was, and what was there a difference in what they wore, the layers that they wore, to sort of, I mean, I definitely feel from in the play that there is an extreme difference in the corsets that Esther wears in comparison to what she makes for Mrs. Van Buren. You know, they're definitely more elaborate and meant to be worn under gorgeous ball gowns, but you know, Esther wears corsets there. Her corsets are beautiful, but they're definitely more simple and don't say as much. So if you could.
The corsets, especially, you know, start in the 17th, 18th centuries, are very much a sign of gentility. You know, it's declared that, you know, it's like the ultimate bad taste to have a large waist. You know, I mean, it's that, and you know, it, like kids, boys and girls are having to of the you know, upper classes of the aristocracy are having to not only wear the stays, but to, you know, they're having to follow like the instruction, dance instruction in terms of posture and how to move. However, really, you know, by the end of the 18th century and certainly in the 19th century, you as the materials become more readily available, like steel boning instead of the baleen or the whale bone, you start to see in women from the working classes wear, and even in the 18th, you know, even in the mid 18th century, you see women wearing the stays and then later the corset, because it is a sign of respectability. It's associated with, you know, with being, you know, discriminating and respectable. So it's a fashion, but it's also very closely tied to, you know, like if you're not wearing one, you're loose. Yeah, that's where that term comes from. They are different, and like you say, I think in terms of material, what is because the silhouette, the reigning silhouette is the fashion, and that stays more or less the same. Although obviously, if you're working, or even, you know, by the early 20th century, even if you're wealthy, but you're playing tennis, for example, you're wearing a very different type of of corset than you would to a ball gown, or even the time of day it changes. You know, so it depends on what you're doing and how much mobility you need.
But feel free to comment on any of this if you'd like.
I was curious about, and I think maybe your initial question was about this, like undergarments versus lingerie, right? So like bloomers versus, you know, the kind of decorative work that's happening in the play. Is there a distinction? So when we say lingerie, are we actually thinking about a style of undergarments, or are we thinking about undergarments in general?
Well, lingerie comes from the French word for linen. And so, you know, all of lingerie really originally referred to actually even men's linen, you know, shirts that were worn as underwear or that women's shifts. And so it's really, I think it was only in the later 19th century that word came to be associated with the more elaborate, corset, I suppose. But throughout, the corset is worn on top of the, you know, the still is worn on top of the shift, you know, the shift is, you know, what's taking kind of the hard wear, and the corset is kind of being protected by the linens from your body.
Can we also talk about, just briefly, this is something I'm curious about, the multiple layers that women had to wear during 1905, because we experienced that in the show. How many of you have seen the show yet? I know we just opened it early in preview, so a good many of you that are here, great, okay. So we are wearing cotton tights we have on a camisole, and then a petticoat, and then the corset. And that's the they've tried to minimize how much we're wearing. Could you talk about those layers and what it's like for someone who is of a lower class, like Esther, to have to work with all of that on? I mean, even just being, you know, on the stage, of course, under the lights, it's incredibly hot, and it must have been a challenge back in 1905 to have all of this fabric that you're covered in, and yeah, having to do everything that you do during the day.
When there were earlier, you know, like say the 1860s, there were, you know, these attempts. This is why, you know, the cage crinoline came in, because, you know, the skirts were having to be supported by, like, you know, three or four petticoats. So, you know, there are certain things that are, you know, in certain pieces of clothing that are invented, and there are patents galore for the corsets around this time and towards the later 19th century. But it's a lot of fabric. However, I think Esther wouldn't have been comfortable wearing anything else, but, you know, that's because she wouldn't have felt respectable. That is part of her character, you know, that, like, the strength and, you know, in maintaining her respect. So there are, you know, you're not lacing, I mean, and you probably experience this too, wearing it, you kind of lace according to your, you know, what you have to do wearing that. So if you're going to a ball, you're probably going to lace really tightly.
Right.
But if you're having to work, or even eat, you know, some women would actually loosen the corset when they had to eat.
For Thanksgiving.
Yeah.
On that note, thinking about Esther and what she, and even women of a lower class, still sort of trying to represent what it is to be a lady in society during that time, what it would have been like for Esther as an African American woman during this time to achieve the things that she did. And you had the opportunity to see the play, and of course, Radiclani, you've read it. And sort of giving us a context within a way in which we can understand how difficult it was for Esther to be this 35-year-old in New York City from the South who could not read, to be able to support herself with an occupation, a skill that she loved and enjoyed. So if you could just talk about that a little bit and what was going on during that time period.
I was learning so much about you. You know, so if this was 1905, Esther would have been one of a very small group of African-American migrants. Large-scale African-American migration to, say, New York City doesn't really start until World War I, and there was a very small African-American population in New York, but there would have been very few migrants. And the city itself would have been filled with new immigrants and old stock Americans, all of them represented very nicely, I think, in the play. And for her to have achieved what she achieved, I mean, the larger question about individual success and opportunity for very particular people is a little different. And I think the play actually does this beautifully, then providing for a structural change that allows for wealth to be passed on, that allows for the accumulation of resources for multiple generations, for families to thrive over generations as opposed to just individual people. So the way in which her own wealth is achieved through her very, very hard work and her skill and craftsmanship, but then, you know, vanishes and she starts right back. Sorry, for those of you who haven't seen it. There's no way to talk about this.
You don't know how it vanishes, though. That's the case.
It's amazing. I think, you know, that sense that you're always at the... you're always whimsically positioned with a little bit of resource and not a lot of permanence attached to it. It's really, you know, profoundly, very much a part of the early 20th century. And the historians have talked about the ways in which civil litigation for African Americans is on the uptick at precisely this moment, because there's a need to find ways to pass along property and personal wealth. And as women and men age, They often distribute their resources to non-family members or to family members, to whomever they trust to take care of them in their old age, because that's a great concern before the social safety net. And so you can imagine as well that Esther would at some point need to worry about who would take care of her when she was older, that she might be concerned about fingers, about hands, about her physical health, and that every dollar that she lost, that she lost somehow, that she may have lost. You know, that I think that, that every one of those precious dollars is another worry added to her, right, about her future, and where would she be when she was, because she's 35 quite locally in the film, so where will she be when she's 55? Who will take care of her in her old age? How will she secure that person's support of her at a moment where it's not always clear that younger generations owe everything to older generations, where older people are worried about what's going to happen to them when they're on their own?
I think just to add on to Esther's struggle, you know, she comes from a father who was a slave and, you know, couldn't speak, and a mother who died. So she comes to New York with absolutely nothing. She comes with nothing except for a hope that she can find something that will allow her to actually thrive and live and build something for herself. And in that same vein, it's interesting to see the four women in this play who are all beautifully written, who are sort of in different pockets of what a woman is in 1905. You know, Esther, who has managed, she represents a small percentage of women who are independent, and then you have Mrs. Van Buren, who is quite essentially, I guess, what a lot of upper class women were. You know, they were simply there to be seen and not heard, to their children, and that was it. You know, she's a socialite and doesn't have an occupation. And then you have Mamie, who is a prostitute slash singer at this, you know, sort of brothel slash music house. And then you have Mrs. Dixon, who is an African-American woman who has a boarding house, a rooming house, that is quite a thing to have and to own as an African-American woman in 1905, but she inherited this from her husband who passed away. So if we could talk about sort of what that means, and those different tiers of status for women during that time period, that would be.
Yeah, I think you actually started doing that.
Okay.
And for me it's actually quite remarkable to read the play and think about African American literature that actually represents this time period, right? Contemporary African American literature of the period. So the first text that I went back to, and I would urge you all to also read as a kind of accompaniment text, is Paul Laurence Dunbar's Sport of the Gods, which is really about a family that's forced to leave the South because of a father being incarcerated wrongly as a result of a lie being told. Mm-hmm. And the matriarch of the family, Miss Hamilton, takes her son and daughter to New York City, to the Tenderloin District, and they stay in a boarding house, and the opportunities, economic opportunities, job opportunities for African-American women in that play mirror the opportunities there in Len Ottage's play. So I think that's quite interesting. So we have someone who's running a boarding house or a SRO. We have women who perform on stage as chorus girls, right? Which I wouldn't necessarily say is equivalent to what Mamie does, as someone who's working in a kind of bordello-like situation. Well, not a bordello, but as a woman of the night,
right,
so to speak. There is the son who actually becomes a ne'er-do-well, and in some ways mirrors the kind of activity that we see George eventually finding himself in, going to bars and a kind of sporting life that most men attended to. And Dunbar is quite dark and fatalistic in his representation of African Americans traveling to the North in search of work. And eventually the whole family is kind of destroyed. And the mother returns to the South, and with the father eventually, the son is on death row for having murdered his girlfriend, who was a chorus girl. And their daughter is essentially a chorus girl, which is the, it's associated with this kind of nightlife activity that's very promiscuous in that sense. So the only thing that I think Nadja's play does really quite differently is that, you know, she gives us George, which speaks to a kind of global economy, right? So we have him being from Barbados, but then also being African American and therefore being a threat and experiencing race in America as a black man in a very similar fashion, right? But we understand that he's working on the Panama Canal. So there are, for all intents and purposes, the employment opportunities for African Americans are essentially relegated to menial labor. And it's only in a kind of, I guess, the trade of the rural economy, right, that if you think of the kind of the women who, from the South, who kept gardens, who made quilts, who sewed, who were seamstresses, who brought those skills to the North, that we see that kind of tie over in the case of our protagonists. So I'm really kind of struck by another layer of production out of all this restriction, right? So, and that for me is the production of a certain kind of modern sensibility, right? And that modern sensibility being inherently bound up with her very conventional stage role as someone who sews. And so intimate apparel for me is about how the proximity between blacks and whites in these kind of closed domestic spaces will eventually allow for something like, say, jazz music, right? The kind of overly, this is a kind of pre-Anglo-American modernist moment happening, right? So we think of someone like Eliot, T.S. Eliot, Pam, their relationship to African-American vernacular culture on the stage or through the music, which becomes the kind of cultural resources that gives us the kind of modernist poetry that we, more often than not, don't read African-American experience into, right? So if you think about Gertrude Stein's Three Lives, Melantha. So there's this, in this play, there's this kind of, this domestic intimacy that is going to be the fuel or engine for modern race relations, for modern types of sexuality. There is the homosocial lapse that happens between Miss Van Buren and Esther, right? There's the possibility of them coming together in some ways beyond just friendship, but as lovers, right? There is the swagger and kind of, you know, sartorial sensibility that is in the apparel that she makes for George, but he just doesn't have the like mental equipage to handle it, right? So he's a throwback. He wants to buy horses, but really she's making him suits that's made for the modern man. And because he doesn't accept the suits, and he gives away the smoking jacket, that, you know, that for me says that this guy is not meant for the 20th century, right? And he's ruining the money. He doesn't save the money, you know? So there are all kinds of ways in which I think we can place a much more sophisticated interpretive dynamic onto this play that doesn't necessarily have to repeat or be expressive of the limitations of African-American cultural productivity, right? So I think there's a way in which we can make this play more rich for us in terms of hope and possibility, and not see it as a kind of limit test on race relations in the dawning of the 20th century, you know?
I mean, you bring up an interesting point, because Esther, what she does, allows her to be in contact with so many different kinds of people. You know, and she gets to experience this array of personalities and races and religion in her experiences through this fabric, which I don't know necessarily, this is what we've been also sort of talking about, if she would have had these experiences had she not been a seamstress, would she have bumped into Mrs. Van Buren? Would she have ever had a conversation with her? Would she have ever met a Jewish fabric seller? Or even with Mamie, which we had to create in, you know, rehearsals, our sort of backstory as to how the two of them ended up being friends, because they are on completely different ends of the spectrum. But how hard would it have been, or easy, if so, for her to have met all these different kinds of people otherwise?
You know, I thought a lot it strikes me that you could tell a parallel story if she'd been a domestic. So she could have circulated in some of the same, it wouldn't have been to a clothier or to someone who's on fabric, it might have been to a merchant of some other kind. But that would have robbed the entire play of the significance of the fabric and of the tactile sensibility that really makes intimacy work in the play. So it wasn't just about her ability to circulate from room to room or from world to world, but about the way in which fabric allowed her to touch and be touched in multiple contexts, and that would have been quite unique, right? So for a domestic to enter or to cross through these worlds, for a cook or for a cleaning woman, right, all of them fairly respectable trades for African American women at this time, you wouldn't have had that same kind of intimacy. So it's the genius of the fabric as a metaphor by the playwright that allows intimacy to be established, to change people, and to move the plot along.
It makes me think also too that even the idea of having a lady's maid who could have been a black woman, you know, that thing is something that is very intimate, but there's still a level at which you are separate and not, you don't have the opportunity to get close to someone, and it's also something that you may not necessarily love to do, but it's the fact that Esther has this occupation that she loves that brings her closer to all of these people that she comes in contact with, because there is this shared, and the vocabulary in which they share their love for these fabrics is very different, you know, because Mamie loves it to a point, but, you know, I feel like, you know, Esther's relationship with Mr. Marks is like the ultimate understanding of what this means to the both of them, but it is through this very specific thing that she does, being a seamstress, that she is allowed the chance to get this close to people and share something that she loves, to be able to give this gift from the heart. It's almost as if whenever she makes a piece of clothing or a piece or a corset or whatever the thing may have been, that she's giving these people, everyone, a piece of herself. And it's like that, those gifts or those things are sewn in her spirit, that they are so much a part of her.
Yeah, I think it's the expertise. I mean, it's the fact that she's got such specific expertise, which is actually waning, that she can own the making of this entire garment for individual women and circulate in the way that she does, mm-hmm. and to own the knowledge of the fabric. I mean, from what I understand, I think that she's especially empowered at this time, because really I think most of the women who were, you know, working in the garment industry at this point in New York especially were working in the factories. And it's right around this time in 1900 that the women's like garment workers union was established. And so she is at a higher level because of the years that she spent, you know, learning this art, I mean, which is an art. And that does allow her to cross through, you know, various parts of society that she wouldn't be able to, you know, be in many places at once if she were a domestic. She wouldn't know both Mamie and Mrs. Van Buren.
I see her as very strong, very independent, very successful, mm-hmm. and she is able to make her own choices, whether it's the choice of the cloth or the choice of the customer.
Right. Yeah, in some ways I think that, you know, Miss Van Buren, I believe, is satisfied with her work as a seamstress, so she wouldn't have her, mm-hmm. right? But she too doesn't really understand the work of art,
right.
that she's received from Esther, and it seems like to me the play, to kind of go back to this issue of like the new and the avant-garde and the modern, is making these kind of, at least these allusions or homages. I mean, I had mentioned earlier, I was like, wow, you know, the melancholic feeling of the play seems to be one that would be more accentuated by the blues as a kind of musical motif. But if we're talking about newness and innovation, mm-hmm. right, and artistic expression, ragtime makes perfect sense. And of course, Mamie can play a rag on the piano. And there is a kind of miscegenated circumstance in the way in which Esther and Mr. Marks interact with one another. And especially, you know, there's a moment telling me where Esther hears Mark's humming. She's like, "Are you humming a rag?" Right? And he's like, "No, it's a Romanian folk song." And all these, you know, this kind of this idea of the kind of polyglot nature of like what goes into what would be, you know, truly classical forms of American musical expression like ragtime and blues and jazz and whatnot is articulated through these subtle allusions throughout the play, right? And even just the sheer tenacity of the entrepreneurship of Miss Dixon, right? I mean, I have an aunt who's still alive who used to have an SRO up until the 80s, you know, and if you go into Brooklyn, New York, there are tons of SROs in Crown Heights and Bed-Stuy, you know, if you're interested in converting a multifamily unit into a residential home, you'll run into all kinds of liabilities and taxes. But so that's a very significant feature in African-American urban life, and in some ways, you know, with the daunting task of dealing with the racial politics of the time, one could say there's an art form to making money, right? And that, you know, these characters in some ways, some of them represent or are reflective of that. And the play is trying to pay respect to it in many ways.
Mm-hmm. Esther, so interesting, is the one person in this play who, the reason why this play even has a life is because there's a moment where she realizes that all her life she's been working. She's been working towards this dream of hers, this thing that she wants, and it occurs to her that she's alone. And for me, you know, it's the point where she wants to be with someone. She wants to be able to share this, what she's done. She wants to be able to share her life with someone and wants a family. Doesn't necessarily, we never really touch on the fact that she never says whether or not she wants children, but we know that she would like to be with someone. And what that would have been like for her to have been married and have a child in 1905, and would she have had to have sacrificed her being a seamstress, if she had gotten married or decided to have a child? How much of that, being an independent businesswoman in 1905, would go away had she actually gotten married and had a child? Any thoughts on that? And I'm just curious, does your independence in 1905 disappear once you have a husband? You know, would he become the breadwinner? You know, how much of that would have still existed for her?
Well, I mean, I think in many cases it wouldn't have just been one child, right? It would have been one followed by another. The narrative of women's lives at this particular moment is one of, you know, the labors of childbirth and child rearing, particularly for working class women. The notion of having it all is impossible. Even having a little is often impossible. Mm-hmm. So it's just as much as we all love children, it's a sort of day-to-day grind of, you know, raising children in a world where you have to give up sugar, where you don't have a lot of the modern conveniences today or the luxuries of today, and where she would have been, you know, where whatever fortune her domestic unit would have enjoyed, you know, could have capriciously been washed away with even a minor financial fluctuation. Mm-hmm. Right? So even the wealthiest African American families at this period in time see fortunes get wiped out by just a tiny twitch of the stock index. Mm-hmm.
I guess I have a question. I mean, would it have been possible for her to give up her career, even if were she to be married? I would think she would have to have continued working nonetheless, and probably even if she had kids, you know, that it wouldn't have, that her, the luxury wouldn't have been to give up her job and her career, but rather to actually indeed do it all. So, you know, like in every waking moment.
She does work at home, so, right, there's no reason in theory why she can't continue to work, and she likely would.
No, I'm not sure too that she would be able to continue working. There's no reason to say no, both financially for me and personally for me.
Mm-hmm. It seems to me that the psychology of the character, so above and beyond the kind of historical context, the psychology of the characters of someone who loves the act of creation and cultivation of fabric and the manipulation of it into an object. And it would be hard for me to imagine her psychologically giving that up.
Right.
Her Esther in particular, as
right.
opposed to the social class she represents.
It's just, it's, and I would agree with that, and I think it's, the play leaves you in a place of wondering how she's going to manage everything, because she's, in a way, not starting from scratch, but because she has her skills still at this point at the end, but you wonder how she's going to manage it all now, because she is, she will have to figure it out, you know, and I wonder what that journey could be for her. That would be lovely to see another play about that, you know, seeing what happens after night, you know, once, I don't want, I hate to be a spoiler, I don't want to hold up a sign and say spoiler alert, but.
1906.
Yeah, in 1906, what is going on with her. But,
One question I have had in mind, she had collected a large sum of money.
Yes.
And from the to the historians, wasn't that enough money to open that store? What was keeping her from, following that dream?
Why, did we ever get a dollar amount? I guess that would be
that. Yeah, we did.
$100 for every year. So, and she's been in New York for 18 years. Yeah.
That was a lot of money.
That's for 1905. That's a fortune, a small fortune.
Well, I mean, the psychological answer would be right. Like she's such a sharp cookie that if she had enough money, she would have opened the store. But what she's clearly planning. So I'm obviously dodging the historical answer. she's clearly pining for something else, right? The opening of the store is the thing she says she wants, but what she really wants is not to be alone.
Right.
It's what they all want. So.
Yes, that's all that I was
done. I'm trying not to be the spoiler either. any more comments? Because I think we'd like to maybe open up the floor for questions or anything before.
Maybe literacy is an issue here. I mean, it's 1905 and she's illiterate, you know, and that's an issue. Well, she's not, she's semi-literate, right? And she's culturally literate, right? But, you know, there is a moment where, there are still great swatches of people in the U.S. who can't read or write, but that's a telling issue.
absolutely, that's the big thing.
It's the thing that forbades her entering into a sophisticated union, right? One of equals. But it turns out, ironically, that it is a union of equals.
Yes.
In that way. I don't know that Nottage is, you know, the class police in this particular situation, but they're in the Tenderloin district, and that's a very particular kind of construction of African American cultural identity in the early 20th century. So, you know, things are not going to turn out well for these types of characters if you were kind of generalizing about African American life in New York at the time. Right, surrounded by all these kinds of attractions. So I wonder about that. And I also wonder about like what the play is saying about marriage and human relationships, mm-hmm. and how what discourse plays in that, and words, and what words mean, and how is it that we come to some kind of understanding of what our needs and desires are. There are always these kind of ruses or misrepresentations and that kind of thing. So I think the play is like much more prickly and cynical in some ways. So, and even though those circumstances of these characters are pretty extreme, I think that they can, you know, be transposed into a more contemporary or modern sensibility in a kind of allegorical way and say things like, well, how is it that people represent themselves to one another? And how is it they represent their dreams? And what are the nature of your dreams, and are these kinds of things doomed to fail because of the inherent nature of them in certain ways? That they can be bought, they can be saved, you know.
Also the idea of sharing dreams, and can we both have our dreams and be in this relationship together, mm-hmm. which is George and Esther sometime, it seems as if one of them is speaking French and one of them is speaking Spanish, because they both want what they want, but how they want it and how they are in the world is so different from the other one. And there is so much hope for them in the beginning. You hope so much, and it's wonderful, the letters, you think they're gonna be a match, and you want so much for them to be on the same page, but when they get in the room together, you just see that what they're thinking and how they're thinking about going about this relationship and what they want in the world, it just doesn't gel together. And that also opens up, you know, sort of how we all communicate with each other and
she's an artist, right? And so like what happens when you take this identity as an artist and you turn it into something with much more utility, right? So you become a functionary, you become a seamstress, but she's an artist and she's compromising her understanding of herself as an artist. That's not always articulated to us, but you know, if that is what's propelling her forward, then maybe more of the play, if we want something more, you know, satisfying in terms of her outcome eventually, it would be that she pursued that dream, mm-hmm. and not the dream of domestic union, which is about hobbling that kind of individual sense of herself, mm-hmm. and aspiring to innovation and that kind of thing, you know?
Yes, questions? Okay, yes, we can start with you.
Okay. I'm a product of, my paternal grandparents were sweatshop people. And they came over in the early 1900s. And I see Esther in higher class than my maternal grandparents were, because they literally came up the phone, they didn't speak English. And they just literally went to work in a sweatshop. Okay, that's one thing. I just curious about how the comics would work about that. Excuse me, the second thing is, why was it necessary to have Marx as Jewish? And that bothered me. Why was it necessary in this play to cast him as a Jewish man?
I think Lynn Nottage wrote it that way to sort of signify the early rise of the melting pot in New York, to show that there were all these different kinds of people coming into New York as it is now. There are so many, it's extremely diverse, also extremely segregated New York now, still in 2014, but to signify that there were all these different kinds of people coming there to make a start, to make a living, to figure out how to build their lives. Feel free to comment on that. I answered it, but if you want to add.
Well, I mean, so part of it might be determined by the trade that she's in. So because she's a skilled seamstress, an artist, the world she's going to circulate in is going to be different. So if she'd been a domestic, right, then the analog might have been a different genre of personhood. But I also think that a part of what the playwright seems to be doing is taking fairly familiar stereotypes, right? So the main characters in the film, except for Esther, who's a bit of a novel creation, right? They're familiar types. And she's complicated them, because they're all allowed very rich moral lives to a certain extent, right? I read the LA Times review of the play, and I was really struck by this phrase that there are villains without villainy in this play. And I think that's, that there are lots of bad things happen, but there aren't always very bad people. We can debate George being bad necessarily, but there are a lot of morally complex people. And she wanted people who were morally complex and who would be closely related. In 1905, a Jewish person from Romania might not have been seen as white. I mean, it's entirely possible in the scheme of classification for Jews to have been understood as Semitic, to have been understood as Oriental or yellow. He would have been much socially closer to her, precisely because of his Jewishness.
She had a higher class. She was making money. My Jewish immigrants, you know what I mean? Forget it. They're in a sweatshop.
But the thing is, he wasn't in the sweatshop. He was in the merchant class, which is where a lot of the Jewish immigrants ended up at that point, because a lot of them were coming over in the about 1880s. And within 20 years or so, they were starting to become into the merchant class. My grandfather came over about 1880, and by the turn of the century, he was a cobbler. He had a shoe shop.
I mean, he's represented as you know, having a great expertise, and you know, and there's a lot of art in what he does, and appreciation of the art. So I mean, he's he doesn't seem to be a flat character to me in the least bit. And he's, and again, he's so much bigger than the person that he is, partly through the material that he's working with and where it's coming from.
Yes, Carol.
I was just going to say, I also think that one of the reasons why she chose to have Esther have a certain faith and then come up against someone who she has so much in common, mm-hmm. and yet she's blocked, they're both blocked by connecting because they feel that their faith won't allow, you know, there's no such thing as an interfaith relationship, never mind the, also the racial mm-hmm. part. And to me, it's very interesting because I think this is incredibly relevant now. I mean, look at our country. It's very polarized by religion as well as by race.
And
so I thought, wow, how, where are we actually? Have we come so far or not?
I thought that was just a heartbreaking, you know, this is like all spoilers.
We've ruined it, we're sorry.
But that was just a heartbreaking scene where you know, you finally understand which two people are truly in love with one another, insofar as they can be in this particular historical context. And they can't touch, right? And so the you know, what lies between them is this, you know, what would be for me a very garish smoking jacket, but I love that they could touch through that. I thought that was just absolutely beautiful.
Well, they all touched each other through the material.
Yeah, when they were touching the fabric, even though they weren't touching it at the same time.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I was, to go back to something you guys were talking about at the very beginning, the relationship that she, I haven't seen the play, I didn't see it on Wednesday, but just the relationship that she has with the various women, and how would she have access to those women, and what is the role of the seamstress in particular that could put her there. My grandmother was a seamstress, actually both my grandmothers were seamstresses, but one came from Italy and worked all the way through, and as you were talking, I was also thinking her husband, my grandfather worked in the silk mills, and when those automated, he lost his job and never worked again, whereas she was always able to work, had four kids, but worked at home because she did individual sewing. And even when I was little, her customers would always come to the house. And she was, one of the people that she became very close to was Mark Twain's great niece, who was one of the wealthiest women in the town that she lived in. And once a year, she would go to Mrs. Langdon's house, and she would tell this story. My tiny Italian grandmother who went to third grade and then started on her dowry would go and sit on one end of the table, and Mrs. Langdon would be on this end, and servants would come in and serve them lunch. But she, the relationship that she had with the women that she worked with, and I then was a hat designer for 8 years and did custom hats. You are not only close to the people that you're working with, but essentially they're trusting you to interpret the expression of who they are and who they want to present themselves to be. And it's an incredibly intimate and kind of fraught relationship. I actually, after 8 years of it, found it so exhausting. It was, I had been a social worker before that, and that was easier. Because you're having to kind of tease, somebody has to trust you enough to say, this is who I am, this is what I want. And not only that the clothes will look good, but that they will fulfill some kind of really sometimes inchoate sense that that woman has of who she wants to be. So that relationship, I mean, the artistry is one thing, but there's something so deep about what that woman is letting her into within her own psyche that she may not even understand until it's expressed, that it's really, I'm dying to see the play now. I mean, I was anxious to get tickets, but this is, there's so many interesting thing. So without having seen it, and I don't know how well that rings true, but just, I remember watching my grandmother's customers and that, and realizing also even as a young child, she would never have known these people, some of the people that she worked with. But also in my own experience, it's a very it's a charged relationship, and there's a kind of trust there.
You see that really early on in the play.
You do. You'll see it. So yeah. I'm glad you're seeing it Wednesday. Yeah. I won't spoil anything. But you're right. You hit the nail on the head. So you'll get to see it. Yeah.
This isn't. But you can have that same experience when you go to Ruth's. I wasn't giving a plug. I am. But I think it's the same intimate relationship of when women come in for their undergarments, when you grow up, and when you go to a place where you're going to expose your body, you're not sure how, you're asking for people who know better than you how to look. And you reveal, and if you keep going to a place as wonderful as Ruth's, you get that, you can trust it, that they're not going to let you leave feeling like about your body. And if the play is bringing up all those issues, which to me are current today, and it's not the same thing as a very detailed seamstress, but when you have that experience, with undergarments and the right people, it's just very intimate. It's what Christina has said, watching
the friends. I was fascinated. My staff was with me when we saw the play. We all saw it together. Mm-hmm. And they were absolutely mesmerized by your character. I mean, you know, they identified with it and were mesmerized. It was a great experience.
So how have women's undergarments both reflected and or influenced the history of feminism in America? I mean, you see corsets restrain women's bodies at the time where they're restrained because they can't vote, and we take that through history to a time when you can be a feminist via bra burning, and like that is a trope. And how is that, going further, how is that existing now? How have things changed, if they've changed at all? Because I feel like women's undergarments in this time, these corsets are meant to help women be beautiful to men, and that still seems to be the case for undergarments now. I mean, I don't know if it is really empowering to be shopping at Victoria's Secret or something like that, because it just seems like it is another device of objectification of women.
Say that that's not true, but I think that there it's more complicated. I mean, I think that you're at any time, it's really how you're feeling in that, when whatever it is you're wearing. There is a lot of choice involved. You know, you can be wearing, I mean, in 1905, you could have still been choosing to wear like the pure white corset. It would have been following the lines. It would have been this extreme S-curve silhouette, which was developed by a woman with a doctor to, because it was supposed to be better for your body, even though it was probably not, because it was all horrible for your back. But developed by a woman because she thought it was better, physically. And I mean, at this time, there are, of course, the corset is tied to all kinds of debate by men, by women, or going on in terms of, I mean, there's the hygienic properties, but also like, yes, women are put into the corset not to make men happy necessarily, but because they're too weak to, they couldn't possibly like hold up their bodies without one. That's one part of the equation. Then there are women who are wearing it because they feel empowered, because it makes them, there is a certain like sensuality that makes them feel good about themselves and their place in the world. I mean, I think it's a very complicated narrative. And so even when you get into the teens and you're looking at, the Greenwich Village and women who are actually like shaking off the corset,
really the majority of women are still, you know, so you get the flapper silhouette, which is called the garçon, the boy silhouette. So you think, well, you know, feminism is like strong, but it's, but the women are wearing undergarments to suppress their curves. They're wearing like, brassieres that basically will erase the bosom. So is that ultimately, you know, is that a feminist stance or is it the opposite?
I think it's interesting in the play that the corset is a rather unlucky piece of clothing. It doesn't produce happy relationships. It fails in three acts. But the outfit that Esther wears, the kind of very serviceable brown outfit with the white top, is the outfit that she wears when she meets Mr. Marx. It's the only item of clothing, you know, that repeats in scenes that are emotionally satisfying, right? Where she has a relationship with someone she cares about. They're fully clothed, it seems to me. Everywhere else, wherever the women wear the corset, they're either unlucky or emotionally shallow, or it's a moment of quiet or unquiet desperation. It's a rather loud scene. So, right. So I think there's a statement in the play about all of this, about the beauty of literature is that it can be read in multiple ways. But you could make a strong reading of the play in which the corset is itself a provocation for us to worry about, right? Like, what is it? Is it both? It can be simultaneously empowering and constraining, and the after effects of that relationship can be uneven, if not sometimes disastrous.
Oh, yes.
Not sure if this is so much a question as a comment, but I know that I was kind of curious about, I forgot the word that was used to describe something like the women of the night, back to the phrase, but I know a long time ago there was an article about Ruth's lingerie in the Providence, I think, that was talking about the trust factor that a lot of the staff of the store would have with maybe the different booths to change, you know, like to check out what size you want, the different occupations that do come in there, that they're, I don't know if it would be seen as a modern interpretation, but exotic dancers, or, you know, kind of maybe the modern take of something of that kind of environment anyway, trying to be visually appealing to a gentleman's club and having some people that come in there to be adjusted in size and to have that trust in one booth, and the very next one might be someone that is a completely different walk of life as far as occupation goes, you know, and that it can be seen as a non-judgmental place, because I'm sure, you know, based on the maturity of that environment, that you have, like I said, in one booth, someone that is seen publicly in what can be seen as kind of a little bit more of an underground environment, and, you know, someone else that's still trusting someone to come in and check them out that way too, and make sure that this fits, because that's really ultimately what everyone wants is, you know, their own relationship with intimate, you know, apparel. Mm-hmm. And like I said, some might have it on display, literally, and, you know, some may not. And I've not seen the play yet, but I did hear about it, and I kind of wanted to get my take. But that article always stuck out in my mind, because that's a very big deal to have an occupation where you might, just in the fittings, that's what I was looking for, the word fittings, kind of hear what someone does do for a living, and kind of still say, just be diplomatic enough or whatever, so that they still come back and don't feel uncomfortable. And so I guess it's a comment.
And if you make this a second career, even though to a certain extent, I could say I grew up with it. I was 8 when the store opened. I was certainly gone for probably 30 years. But you're correct. I mean, I can remember the day when we had the woman from the Foxy Lady there.
I didn't want to point out.
Right. But we have the nun in the next dressing
room. Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That's
when the nuns took off the very heavy habits, all of the nuns from the convent that was near us walked down to the store to get their first garments. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think it is, you know, our staff likes what they do. each individual is different, and each is, you know, presenting a different scenario, and each of us have different needs. And undergarments are important to women, and it doesn't matter what walk of life.
But you do also have some, I guess, some men.
Yes, occasionally. Yes, no, actually we do. We don't really have room for them to change. And in the world that's changing, we have transgender. You know, people going, but yeah, we actually see it all. It's a very private shore, but it's like being. Sometimes it's like being the beautician, you know, who's hearing all of the gossip, being the bartender. It's a unique field, and I identify with that in terms of the role she was playing.
Yes, Esther, who definitely plays that part of providing something that they that these women are going to love despite what they do. You know, she doesn't judge Mandy until it comes back in the kitchen.
Both of the women, she was their confidant. She played a unique role. She was a great, and to me, race made less of a difference. I didn't even see it necessarily. It was the role of what she did that I saw.
I agree.
It's interesting to me as a patron of Ruth's on occasion. There's this community of women that once you go to Ruth's and you walk in the door and these wise women, no matter who waits on you, eye you up and down and say, you are wearing the wrong bra. You absolutely have no idea what you're doing. Let me help you. And there's this wisdom and trust that when you walk in the door, they know exactly what they're talking about and they know how to dress you in a way that you will be happy. And there's something about going to it's a skill, and it's something that you don't see a lot. I mean, you don't see a lot when I go to a store, somebody says, oh yeah, the blue sweaters are over there. There's not, oh, what you need is this particular garment to fix whatever you need fixed, to help you look like you want to look. And it's something that they just, something that you see in Esther is that she sees the woman. You know, there's something that you see at your store as well.
And my mother's tax return, where it asked me, what's your occupation? She was a corsetier.
I just also wanted to add to what Marilyn was saying. You are made comfortable with your body wherever it is, which is it's interesting. It's such a dichotomy because, like the young woman in the back was talking about, well, why are we even wearing bras? Well, actually, some of us really need to. There's weight, and you can have back problems. Not myself, but my daughter needs a certain construction, and you know, it's important, or she's going to have serious back problems. And I needed a particular bra because I had a mastectomy, and I was told, go to this place, and it took a lot of work, and one of the things that I remember was the particular fabric, because my skin had been so sensitized by radiation. And so when I saw this play, it brought all of that back, and how, you know, intimacy on so many levels, even being comfortable in your own skin. And to me, when you talk about lingerie has that generic term that has gotten narrowed. To me, lingerie is the stuff that makes your skin feel good. And that's a lot of what, to me, it's about these people who are in various stages of not being comfortable in their own skin and struggling to find that.
Esther especially, and there are many moments throughout the play where you see that what she looks like on the outside is something that has not been stressed as being important to her. And it's not something that someone has ever said to her, you know, you look nice, or it's all right if you put on lipstick, or that you should focus on it. You know, she's a working woman who has a purpose, who needs to survive and live for herself. And so the exterior is something that she doesn't focus on, but she's able to provide it for someone else, which is why it's so dynamic, that though she does not give that to herself, she has the ability to give it to someone else.
And she wants to share it with everyone, Mr. Marks, Mrs. Van Buren, Mamie, and George when he comes along. Anything else?
Where does this idea about her wanting to open a beauty parlor come from? It's a completely different occupation, you know.
Yeah.
But it reminds me of, I watched these old movies, I only have a VHS player, so it was Whoopi Goldberg what's his name, Harris, that Patrick Harris, that long name. When he was a little kid, he was in this movie where she takes him under her wing because his baby sister died and the parents, like, going to divorce because they can't take what happened. And she takes, all of her black relatives that live in the bigger city, it's a beauty parlor. And that's where everything happens. That's so much, you know, camaraderie and happiness. And that's all I could think about when I'm thinking about Esther wanting to have this beauty parlor, is in my mind, I'm watching this movie. I can't remember the name of it, but.
Absolutely.
But I mean, where does she decide that that's going to be where her fortune really is going to be? Or where her, you know, like her, her retirement.
That's ultimately what she wants. I mean, I think it stems, of course, out of her making these wonderful garments. Though she has not experienced someone loving her and doting on her and telling her that she's beautiful and wonderful, except for Mr. Marks and their very sort of coded way in which they communicate through the fabric, but it's something that she realizes that colored women need. She realizes that that's something that women like her need, and she wants to be able to provide that. That's, for me, that's where that dream stems from, knowing that she has, that her heart is being able to give that to someone else. And I think that's why she shares it with Mamie, because they have this very delicate, intimate moment where they both share their, you know, ultimate dream. And that's something that she's been thinking about for years and has been saving for, but has never said to anyone. And it comes from this great need to want to give. It's that simple for me, at least. Yeah. Yes.
It's interesting that opening a beauty parlor would have been a return to a more segregated existence, mm-hmm. to a certain extent, right? It wouldn't, if she'd opened a beauty parlor, it would have been limited to a largely black clientele. There would have been far less, mixed race intercourse, metaphorically speaking, through the beauty parlor itself, and
yeah.
that adds a texture to that future tense for her that I think is really interesting.
But I think that, and not that she intends it to be something that makes her world more segregated, but I think she sees that there's a need there for women of color, and she wants to be able to provide that.
Wants to pamper.
You know, yeah, she sees Mrs. Van Buren and what her life is like, though it's very, you know, tainted and has its ups and downs, but I think through her she sees this sort of lack of so many things for women of color, and she wants to be able to provide just a glimmer of something nice and kind for women who, for the most part, don't get to experience that at all.
I was wondering if maybe what the reason was, because I haven't seen it, it could be that it's about transformation, like what she's doing in her occupation is transforming people through being a seamstress. And a beauty parlor, I mean, I like he said, it may have been limiting, ironically, but you transform, it's transformative when you are in a beauty parlor, too. Mm-hmm. And then maybe that's the gift that she's giving people, her own and just at large, is, you know, that ability to transform. And speaking of corsetry, I mean, over the years, what someone touched on, or several people have touched on, is that it was limiting, you know, physically restricting. And now, I mean, we've gone through superheroes, Wonder Woman, you know, there's all these different takes on what corsets look and make people feel like the CBS Victoria fashion show, and, you know, I know that that's, you know, commercialism, but nonetheless, what they, their take on things and how, you know, the fantasy of it all, what they kind of use corsets to look like and illustrate. So I think it's about transformation. Mm-hmm. And the beauty parlor, to me, I think definitely people go in one way, definitely come out another.
Yes.
did you have something?
Well, I was just thinking that talking about, or someone had mentioned about how the lingerie has changed from being very restricted to kind of being more free and loose, but I don't think that really has, that not much has changed. It's still pretty much the same. I mean, now you, I'm Colombian, so in our culture, or in maybe Latin American, the body and the form and lingerie, that's very, still very important for women. And for example, I get to choose, I have corsets, and I have just only four just to make myself like look thinner, not sex, I mean, I have sexy ones, I guess, but the ones that are, you know, now they have different fabrics and latex, and I really could have like my waist look very small if I want. And I wear that sometimes, and it makes me feel empowered. Or, you know, it makes me feel like I have to sit up straight, and I'm conscious of my stomach, and like I have to be, you know, and I know that I look like that iconic, I can give myself the iconic figure of the small waist and the lifted breast, you know. And I don't wear that all the time, but when I want to, when I'm going out, maybe I'll, for like a special occasion, I'll do it, you know. But then again, you know, it's like, for example, men would have, oh, yes, you wear that mata pasione, that passion killer. Like, oh, no, it's not a thing, you know. But when I, you know, if I go to work or every day, I mean, I'm not going to restrict myself, you know. So it's, I don't know, I think it's just a matter of preference. And you had mentioned that depending on what you're doing for the day, you wear lingerie that is appropriate for the day. So, I guess the only thing that has changed would probably be the material. How they're made. Now it's more comfortable, and you have the latex, and you have different, and you have choices, and you make it lacy and pretty, and you make it, it could be an hour, you could wear the undergarment, you know, you could wear out, like a Madonna kind of thing, but that's the mainstream. It's just a comment.
Thank you, yeah, thank you. Oh, Jordan.
Just in response to that, I mean, I was just thinking about an article I read recently about how Spanx, if you don't know what Spanx are, I mean, that's kind of what you're talking about now. I think that it's like a, you know, some people still buy corsets, but they're certainly not made like, and maybe yours are, like, by an individual person who's, like, measuring it to your body. It's usually just like a one-size-fits-all sort of, and then you just cinch it as much as possible, and that's sort of like a specialty item, but Spanx are like everywhere, and again, that's like that's a huge thing. And there was an article recently about how Spanx are just as bad for you as corsets, and how they like they decrease your digestion and obviously circulation and actually ventilation, which I won't get into a little bit. But how Spanx are like the new sort of corset. Can you both either one of you talk about how Spanx like have evolved, or are they better for you, or even like are they helping to increase that illusion, like you were talking about how women don't want any lines, but at the same time, are they making that, those like curves that they're designing?
I think the one thing I don't like the word. I had difficulty with that whole brand and the whole branding of it, you know, and that goes into something different that I think we're all, as women, affect us. Where did they come up with that? You know, I see it from sexual terms and from, and you know, why Spanx? I haven't quite figured that. And when the marketing happened, that has become such a household word. There's definitely, you know, they don't talk about corsets and girdles. I mean, you know, that word hasn't even really come up. They talk about shapers now.
Right.
So that it's to shape the figure is kind of like the big thing today. Which is kind of a slightly different concept than holding it, you know, it's molding it in a way, is what they try to emphasize, I think. But I think of the underwear from the viewpoint of comfort, you know, in mobility and support. And also there's always that overtone of sensuality. And I think that's the part, that piece of the pie. I'm not sure. I think women like to wear pretty things, and then it makes them feel pretty. And I find that most women seem to buy for themselves more than they're necessarily buying for men. It's what inner what makes them feel good is what we tend to see. All of the issues we talked about today, they still emerge. There are certain communities where they would only wear white undergarments. There are certain women that will only be fit on top of, like the chemise that you're talking about from that era. That still exists today, particularly in some of the Mormon communities, that we don't really talk about very often. So where are women going today? I think we're all confused. Can I tell you one thing?
And how new are things, really? I mean, I think that, the latex was, it came out in the 1930s, and that's why, with the silhouette that, what starts to emphasize the curves again, and you have this bias cut coming in that's really, hugging the body, that's when a latex comes in, and you're wearing essentially Spanx, if you want to fit into those, or,
From the Colombian community, what we see most are the rubber-based garments. Which we still carry, which is both cotton on the inside and rubber.
Might breathe better than
that. I don't know, the other has cotton, it's natural fabrics.
It's true.
I'm not sure. European wear whites. Americans want everything in beige and smooth. And you don't see anything. It's like the illusion there's nothing there, even though there's supposed to be something there.
She'll run with me. She's learning so much.
Now, is part of the reason that she hadn't done that because she obviously had enough money to do it? That she was still illiterate, and to open a business, you would need to be able to
married,
right?
Because I definitely think a large percentage of the reason why she doesn't is because she can't read, and she would have to have a business partner who she could trust to do those sorts of things for her. And also that, in 1905, I don't know how many women around were self-sufficient in the sense that they had their own business, as in like a physical building where you could go and it was their own. I mean, I don't know, I'm sure it was extremely difficult, but I guess, you guys can talk about that. What that would be, what would Esther have to do if she were single to actually buy a building, employ people to actually do all of those things, even if she could read, what would she have to do? Because that of two is limiting, it limits her actually, following through on those dreams, but the specifics of it would be interesting to know.
I don't know how difficult property transactions were, like, acquiring property and going to the municipal building to get deeds and that sort of thing. So I'm not really sure about it. I slightly disagree with the idea of a more kind of interpretive dream of like what beauty parlors will do. I think it is more pragmatic, I think, in line with the question that you're making. In the 19th century, at least all throughout the antebellum period, post-emancipation in New York and Massachusetts and Rhode Island and these states, African Americans opened up barbershops, these kinds of segregated businesses were much more efficient and didn't have to deal with the prying concerns of whites who can sometimes kind of muddy up the business terrain, as it were. So I think it's that's more achievable And in some ways, again, it's reflective of her compromising, right? And having these kinds of, I think, functionary ideas about her existence, as opposed to seeing herself as an artist who could probably do something much more expansive. Can you imagine Marx and Esther coming together and opening up a haberdashery shop? Or, you know, I mean, that in and of itself could be scandalous given the nature of their racial union. But I could, you know, that seems far more likely and more down the road of doing something that's in line with her kind of individual concerns. But it's, I think it's an issue of efficiency. And William Wells Brown, when he escaped from slavery, was a barber. And any number of chop houses and oyster houses on Atlantic Avenue in the antebellum period in New York were owned by African American women. If you go down Fulton Avenue in Bed-Stuy now, you know, what's the first thing African immigrants do? They open up braid shops and hair salons. It's just a lot easier. You're dealing with a familiar community. You might know exactly what kind of styles people from your region of a particular country or area would prefer. So it's, I think this is kind of a quick fix. It's you start small and kind of catapult yourself into a greater success.
At least two of the best known African American women successful entrepreneurs Madam C.J. Walker and Josephine Baker also sold these products. So you know, the whole early 20th century includes a lot of African American women who became successful entrepreneurs and very successful entrepreneurs through beauty.
And while I saw her as illiterate in letters, I didn't necessarily see her illiterate in numbers. I mean, she was
very true.
Yeah.
And then I think you can manage if you can, you know, calculate what you owe me.
And I mean, it seemed like the proposal was for her to own a beauty shop, but not necessarily to be doing the labor of it, right? So that's a step up for her. She's removing herself from the manual labor. As good as she is, as wonderful a craftsperson as she is, it's still hard work, and it can be debilitating work. I would think that is a dream of stepping up and being a proprietor of an establishment. It's independence.
One last thing: would you have been able to have? Where would you have learned to read?
Schools in New York. African Americans can actually go to school in New York.
There are a great many people coming from all parts of the world to New York City who don't speak or read English. And so there's a lot of informal and formal ways for people to pick up the language or learn to read. It's not to say everyone's literate, but it is to say that there are lots of opportunities to become. She certainly represents a kind of motivated petit bourgeois spirit, it seems to me. I just think it's really interesting, this idea that that she would come from the Deep South, enter an integrated space that was rapidly diversifying and psychologically complicated for her, and that her goal in life would be to return to something as familiar as a black-only beauty shop. I think that adds to that melancholic tone that you were describing before, and it suggests to me as a viewer of the play that this world, these four rooms that she's moving through throughout the play, that they're much more, they're less happy places for her than other places might be, right? That they're fraught with psychological complexity, and there was a reason why she returns to Mrs. Dixon in the end, because that's a kind of, that represents a world that she might be more comfortable with in some ways.
It's where she began, essentially, her life on her own as an independent woman in the world. It was there, and that's where she learned how to sew. She was taught by someone there. So home is where the heart is, I suppose, yeah. Anything else? No? Okay. All right, well, let's give our panelists a round of applause.
so much for coming out and participating in the discussion. If you've seen the show, please pass the word, tell your friends, those of you who are going to see it, thank you. Please see it. If you aren't thinking about it, you should. But thank you all so much. Thank you.